Okay, let's get started. My name is Andrea Aria DeVoe, and I am a contributing editor at Goop, where I write a monthly column about sustainability and environmental justice. I'm also an executive producer on the short documentary Straws, which is how I came to join the executive advisory board of Plastic Pollution Coalition. So today I'd like to welcome you to the Plastic Pollution Coalition Global Webinar Series. In this series, we bring together our global community to share the latest information, tips, and resources to help stop the growing plastic pollution crisis. Plastic Pollution Coalition is a growing global alliance of more than 1,200 organizations, businesses, and leaders in 75 countries working to educate, connect, and advocate for a world free of plastic pollution. Now we're going to do two poll questions. So for the first poll question, tell us more about yourself. Well, it's looking like that most of you are concerned citizens, and we have a lot of people in working for NGOs as well. This poll is asking what areas of plastic and fashion most interest you. Sounds like everybody's concerned with all of the above. Today's webinar is presented in partnership with Fashion Revolution. Fashion Revolution is the world's largest fashion activism movement, formed after the Rana Plaza factory collapse in Bangladesh in 2013. It was a tragedy that killed over 1,100 people. Fashion Revolution campaigns for a clean, safe, fair, transparent, and accountable fashion industry. They do this through research, education, collaboration, mobilization, and advocating for policy change. It has grown to become a global movement with offices and teams of volunteers in 90 countries. Fashion Revolution Week will take place April 19th through the 25th of 2021, and it is an event that's designed for the global community to create a better fashion industry. This year, the event will focus on the interconnectedness between human rights and the rights of nature. Their campaign will amplify unheard voices across the fashion supply chain and harness the creativity of the community to explore innovative and interconnected solutions. So today I will be in conversation with Lauren Ritchie. She is the founder of the Eco Justice Project, and she's a PPC Youth Ambassador. Maxine Bédin, she's the founder and director of the New Standard Institute and the author of the upcoming book, Unraveled, The Life and Death of a Garment. Imari Walker, she is a science communicator and environmental engineering PhD candidate at Duke University. And Tahira Harrison, the fashion and beauty editor at Teen Vogue. We're going to be discussing the connection between plastic and fashion, from the way microplastics in our clothing are polluting the air and water, to the processing of the synthetic materials and their toxic effects on garment workers, and a lot of unintentional greenwashing that happens in the industry. So with this knowledge, brands, as well as concerned citizens, can make better choices and stay true to their values, while also taking real action towards social and environmental justice. Each panelist will have 5 minutes to present, and then we'll have a moderated Q&A discussion. So we have a lot of panelists today. We have four panelists, and each of them brings so much to the table. So we may not have a lot of time for questions, but we will do our best. Our first speaker is Lauren Ritchie. Lauren is a 19-year-old climate activist, writer, podcast host, and third-year student from the Bahamas studying sustainable development and political science at Columbia University. She is the creator of the Eco Justice Project, a digital platform that educates on global climate justice, promotes intersectional climate action, and seeks to make sustainable living more accessible and inclusive by amplifying the voices of marginalized communities. She's also a writer and content strategist for Brown Girl Green, a youth ambassador for Plastic Pollution Coalition and the Global Wildlife Conversation, and the co-host of the podcast Black Girl Blueprint, a platform to center the voices and celebrate the accomplishments of young Black women in a vast array of fields. She is a total powerhouse at 19.
Thank you so much for the introduction, and thank you so much for having me here today. I'm so excited for this conversation and everything that we're going to be talking about. As was mentioned about me, I grew up in the Bahamas, so that has greatly shaped my perception of not only sustainability, but also fashion. Growing up with somewhere that didn't have access to thrift stores, especially as we think about living in New York now, That's a big part of what we consider to be sustainable living. So no thrift stores, no malls, not really being able to shop online for clothing because shipping takes so long, trying to get places to islands. So all of this has really adjusted my relationship with the way that I think about fashion consumption, but also just, you know, the narrow view that we have of sustainability within the United States. So I think especially thinking about my work with the Eco Justice Project and how that really seeks to make sustainability more inclusive, to make sure that we're advocating for marginalized communities in these conversations. And as we navigate this conversation that we're about to have today, I really want to make sure that we're framing this conversation to make sure that we recognize that we always have to be as inclusive as possible in terms of race, in terms of income, even in terms of clothing size. I know we don't think about that often enough, but for the most part, a lot of fast fashion brands are the more size inclusive ones, and sustainable brands can be a lot very expensive. So keeping all of that in mind, especially considering location and accessibility as well, when we have any conversations about fashion in the industry and sustainability. All that being said, the fashion industry definitely does have a long way to go, and I'm very, very grateful for conversations like this that, you know, give us a platform to talk about sustainability in fashion and, you know, make this information, especially this education, accessible in a way that it might not have been before. There's a lot that we're going to go into today. Some of the questions about greenwashing, I think, is a major thing, especially, not sure if everyone saw, but the H&M new sustainability ambassador in line that just recently came out is a great example, and how, you know, that really changes how we need to define sustainability when it comes to fashion, and explaining to brands that, you know, slapping a green label on products is not enough to be sustainable without actually, you know, taking waste into consideration and overproduction into consideration. And I think especially the thing that we're gonna talk a lot about today, plastic into consideration. So I think especially conversations about plastic within sustainability are incredibly interesting. And I think the best example that I like to use in terms of sustainability and fashion is that for a long time, we'd considered vegan leather to be one of the most like sustainable alternatives, just because it wasn't made from animal products. But at the end of the day, vegan leather is most of the time just plastic, and that's not sustainable in and of itself. So there's a lot to get into today about intersectionality and accessibility and what we need to see in terms of changes to the sustainability movement and to fashion. But like I said, I'm really excited to be here and to be able to offer that Gen Z college student studying sustainable development perspective for this conversation. And I'm really excited to get into your questions in this conversation and to have the opportunity to be with all of these great panelists. So that's me. I'll give it back to you, Andrea.
Thank you so much, Lauren. There is so much to talk about. Okay, so our next panelist is Maxine Beda. Maxine is the founder and director of New Standard Institute. NSI is a think tank that uses data to drive accountability in the fashion industry. She is also the author of the upcoming book, Unraveled, The Life and Death of a Garment. Prior to NSI, Maxine was the co-founder and CEO of Zadie, an e-commerce site dedicated to sustainable designers, as well as its own clothing line. Zadie was named one of the world's most innovative companies in retail by Fast Company. She's been recognized by Oprah in her Super Soul 100 for leaders elevating humanity, and she serves as an ambassador for Rainforest Alliance. She has spoken at some of the world's leading conferences, including the WWD Apparel and Retail CEO Summit. And she's also been featured as an expert by Bloomberg, the Financial Times, Vogue, Forbes, Business of Fashion, and CNN. Beda began her career in international law, working at the Rwandan Criminal Tribunal and Allen Overy. And she received a Juris Doctor with distinction from Columbia Law School. Welcome, Maxine.
Thank you guys so much for having me. And I am so thrilled and honored to be here with these amazing panelists and honestly learn from them as well. As Andrea said, my name is Maxine and I'm the director of the New Standard Institute. And what we're really trying to do, I think Lauren kind of tee this up so nicely, is my starting point into fashion, as Andrea said, I'm a lawyer by background, was not the fashion space. It was being a consumer of fashion and having a closet overflowing with clothing and a feeling like I had nothing to wear. And that was really my deep dive into just really trying to reconnect, not reconnect, to connect for the first time, to be honest, with the clothing that I cover myself in every day. And so I just started by pulling everything apart and really trying to understand what were the things that I was wearing, why was I wearing them, what did, you know, it started with really aggressive Googling of like all of the different labels and what did that mean and what were all these different euphemisms that were out there. And as I just kept digging and digging, the more I realized that, fashion and the work that I had gotten to participate in before at the UN, they were all tied together in how fashion is made, produced, marketed, sold to us, distributed, and then ultimately destroyed. And so I was just thinking about the theme of today's talk and phasing plastic out of fashion, really in order to answer how do we phase plastic out of fashion, it's almost how do we phase fashion out of fashion. And I think that in the journey of this book that I've been able to do, which has allowed me to travel around the world following the creation and ultimate destruction of our clothing, what I've come to see and kind of uncover is just how much the rise of these plastic-based materials coincide exactly to the rise of disposable fashion business models. And so they are so very highly intertwined. And now synthetic materials, so these plastic-based materials are the predominant fiber choice for clothing writ large. So it's really a matter of if we are serious about addressing plastic pollution, we have to get serious about the business models of fashion that have come to dominate just in the past generation. And I think just kind of finally to round things out and not take too much time is that getting a historical perspective on this, I think is incredibly on fashion more broadly, both to understand, as Lauren was mentioning, that the intersectionality of these issues. I mean, cotton, for example, is a significant driver of slavery globally and of this kind of unfettered capitalism. For millennia, humans dressed themselves in natural fibers. And it was only in the 50s. So it's really only within, a real generation, popularized only in the 70s, and really took off only 20 years ago, that plastic has come to displace and become the dominant fiber. So I think it's important to have a historical lens when we're looking at these things, because it also helps to put things in perspective and see that this is the way it is now, but it doesn't have to be like this going forward. So, and thank you guys so much, Plastic Pollution Coalition, for putting this on, and for Fashion Revolution for being partners in this. And I was, we were proud to be the U.S. Cheerleaders of Fashion Revolution in their early days, and they're doing such important work. So I'm really excited to learn and hear from my fellow panelists, and thank you guys so much for listening in.
Thank you so much, Maxine. All right, so our next panelist is Imari Walker. Imari is a PhD candidate at Duke University, where she's investigating the fate, occurrence, and transformation of plastic additives within freshwater environments. In particular, her dissertation work focuses on endocrine disrupting chemicals like BPA that are of concern to human health and the environment. Before Duke, Imari completed her bachelor's in marine science at UC Berkeley. And alongside her PhD work, Imari uses her science communication-based YouTube channel to share information about plastic pollution, microplastics, and the chemicals associated with consumer products. Imari, I'll let you have the floor.
Thank you all for having me here today. So yes, like said previously, I normally study plastics and chemicals associated to plastics. And today I'm going to talk a little bit about how that fits in with clothing. So first, let's take a minute to explore the life cycle of a plastic piece of clothing. And by plastic, I mean polyester, acrylic, rayon, and even nylon fabrics that make our clothes, carpets, and furniture. These synthetic textiles are made from crude oil and are a growing proportion of the use for plastics today. The very moment these plastic fibers are woven into shirts and athleisure wear creates a potential health risk to workers. For in the process of making these clothes, microfibers are created and released into the air, can be inhaled into the lungs, and potentially cause lesions or tumors in high enough exposure. Microfibers are just like microplastics that you see in the news almost every day. They come from plastic and they are broken apart into smaller pieces by mechanical processes like making the clothes themselves to weathering processes in the environment. Now, when this new article of clothing arrives at your door, sometimes when you open it up, you can smell like a new car. That smell is nothing other than polymer additives that are used in the creation of the plastic item itself, and even used to preserve that clothing. These chemicals include phthalates, dispersed azo dyes, and even perfluorinated compounds, sometimes even formaldehyde. Some of these chemicals are known to cause cancers and can be reproductively toxic to the human body. And I'd say most of the chemicals in plastics are not well studied or even disclosed to the public. Now, your first wash of that article of clothing can remove some of the residual chemicals from the surface of your clothing, but these chemicals will be slowly released over years to sometimes decades as you sweat and continually wash your clothing. And this release rate is really dependent on the material properties of your clothing and the chemical properties of the additives that are on the clothes themselves. But it's not just chemical exposure that we have to worry about. For the moment you wash these clothes, thousands of microfibers are released into wastewater. And the moment and the amount of fibers that are released actually depends on the age of the clothing type, the way that it's woven, the temperature of the water used to wash them, even detergents, and how it's just continually cared for over time. And unfortunately, full recovery of these microfibers is a very complex and sometimes impossible task. For example, a polyester fleece jacket removes an average of 1.7 grams of microfibers with each wash and can flow into our wastewater. Roughly 96% of those microfibers are captured from our using wastewater processes into the sludge, and then the rest can end up being dumped into our rivers, eventually oceans, and sometimes into our drinking water. And unfortunately, that 96% of removed microfibers can then be reapplied as fertilizer in the soil that's used to grow our foods. Thus, microfibers are reintroduced into our environment through our air, soil, and sometimes even our water. Microplastics, once in our environment, can cause physical harm to marine life through entanglement, starvation, and sometimes altered feeding rates. These fibers can be consumed by marine life and have the potential to be concentrated up the food chain to the seafood dinner that you eat, you know, on whatever basis you eat that. But we've also seen that these microplastics can break down into smaller pieces called nanoplastics. And those, because they're so small, have the potential to move into the tissue. Evidence on the human scale has shown microplastics in the human colon and the placenta of pregnant mothers. And we have very little knowledge on the health implications of all of these microfibers in our air, in our water, in our soils, in our food, and in our body. And so the knowledge that I've gained from researching microplastics in our environment really comes with the responsibility to kind of share this knowledge and confront the global issue. So I urge you all to learn more about what you're wearing, how you're taking care of those clothes, and push to create stronger transparency in the textile making process, along with reducing your textile consumption and thus reducing microfiber pollution into our environment.
Thank you so much, Amari. That was a really great scientific perspective. Okay, I'm going to introduce our last panelist. There's just so much good stuff to talk about. So our last panelist is Tahira Harrison. Tahira is the fashion and beauty editor at Teen Vogue and part of the team responsible for the incredible content being produced by the magazine. I'm especially impressed by the hashtag fashion crisis series. So Tahira, please tell us more about the great work you're doing with Gen Z and at Teen Vogue and in general.
Hi everyone, nice to meet you. I'm Tahira Harrison. I've been the fashion and beauty director at Teen Vogue for the past 2.5 years. And I guess my intro into just like being more conscious about the environment was actually 2 years before that when I worked at Lenny. One of the last projects I got to work on was going to Mexico and snorkeling to see like the coral reefs and kind of like how they were changing and what bleached coral reefs look like. I got to like snorkel at night and kind of like see how it was changing, and then also just seeing how like the seagasm was just like all over the beach and just like how the environment was changing up close rather than just hearing people talking about it. And I got really into just like being more conscious about the environment, from the way I shop to like what I'm wearing to just like what cleaning products I use. It just helped me just like be more conscious. And also, so I took that with me to Teen Vogue and really wanted to kind of start and help educate our readers. And I think what I noticed is that like a lot of times when we are talking about conscious consumption, it's one, when we all are talking about being like conscious of the environment, specifically within fashion, it's one, always talking about kind of like what you should be buying. And two, oftentimes it is with our readers are Gen Z. So a lot of them are either like graduating from high school or like starting college or starting their first job. So a lot of the times the price of those clothing that they say are expensive, or like everyone says that you should thrift shop or secondhand shop, but like don't realize like a lot of the time that excludes plus size women. So I think my role at Teen Vogue has been really how to tackle all these conversations, because there's a lot of contradictions within the things that we tell people to do, and it doesn't really apply to everyone. Some people live in like clothing deserts and just like a lot of different things I think I've been trying to like approach. So my number one thing is to approach teaching our readers about sustainability and conscious consumption without shame. So if it is, you just graduated from high school and you can only afford this amount, so that means you can only shop here. Like, I don't want you to feel bad about where you're shopping or things like that. It's more about educating. And I think one of the main things is to change the mind of the consumer. Like, what does it mean to consume? I think that's also another thing. Like, how should you be shopping? When should you be shopping? How can you not shop? So really like getting those fundamental things, because it's like you can't keep throwing information at young people when like the way that they were taught to consume is like to buy everything in sight or to always have new things. So I think just starting from ground one and changing that mindset and then building upon like the facts of how do you do that. And one of the series that I did work on, which Andrea mentioned, was Fashion Crisis. We won an award at Condé Nast, like within the building, for our package. And that was just a really cool and fun thing that I got to work on. And I'm just continuing to do that work and educating our young Gen Z readers, because they are the people who are going to have to live with the aftermath of what's happening in the planet. So I think just really educating them on how to take part in that, and also not just take part individually, but how to also call out brands and, you know, policy and do everything they can to kind of like make the world a better place for them.
Thank you so much, Tahira. It's a lot for Gen Z to take in and process and and make decisions. So a lot of people have questions. Well, we got one question during the intro about how should we receive the popularity of recycled plastic fashion items?
Sure. So I remember, I think it was a little over a year ago, where we were doing some research on this and really digging into the industry papers on plastic. I'm sure Amari can speak to the science behind it, but it was just, when you read the plastic industry press, it's like a whole different conversation than what is being marketed. and fashion is seen as like the great savior for the plastic industry because it's this new like stream of business. The problem with the recycled plastic bottle and the entire premise that it's removing bottles from landfill, like the way that plastic bottles are taken away from landfill are whether we have A, the recycling systems, and B, the citizen behavior to do that. And most of, when we started to really dig into the fashion industry itself, most of that recycled polyester, these recycled plastic bottles, rPET, is coming from the feedstock of plastic bottles. And in the bottling industry, it's a much more closed loop system so that it's not perfect, but that a plastic bottle can then become part of a plastic bottle again. And in the fashion industry, we don't have that. There is nothing at scale to recycle these materials. So, the bottling industry have their own targets for using recycled materials. So it's a massive effort only to drive up the price of rPET, but does nothing. It's not actually taking plastic out of landfill. It's completely just inaccurate. There's the story. It's BS. Is that, am I?
It's BS. Yeah. Connecting to Amari's talk on microplastics, and it's still creating microfibers in the environment. And I'll let you explain that more.
Yeah, I was going to say, Maxine did a really great job kind of explaining the problem. And I think for some, they may not know that like less than 10% of all plastic is actually recycled. And it really depends on the polymer type itself, if it is recyclable. When you think about the recycling number on a plastic item, it doesn't mean that it can be recycled. It just tells you the polymer type. There's not a lot of systems in place. So that's where the fighting comes, because there's two main plastic types that everybody wants to use in their recycling content. If we think about the question from the perspective of microfiber or microplastic release, you're still, adding to that problem. It's still, consumption of plastic clothing. And so the question is, what is that recycled fabric used for? Does that require the same amount of washing as a normal plastic product that you're using? Is it the lining of a jacket versus that you don't wash as often versus, athleisure wear? So I think it doesn't necessarily solve the full problem or even solve closing the loop on plastic in its use, because you're still going to require more virgin material to then create the bottle, to then create the clothing. It's not the foolproof solution to our problems.
Thank you so much. Now I want to shift to a topic that Lauren brought up about, being from a Caribbean island, because we got a great question from a woman in Kenya. I'm from Rusinga Island, a remote island in Kenya. I'd like to get ideas of how I can work with my community on sustainability on both fashion and plastic reusing.
I think I can kick things off a little bit. I think I've been having a lot of these conversations recently about what it means to be participating in sustainability and not being in the global north, not being in the United States, where we tend to just think about it as being vegan and being zero waste and, thrifting and all of these things are, what we tend to subscribe to being sustainable, being eco-friendly. And that's just not the reality for growing up in the Caribbean or for just not having that access to do those things. And I think one of the most interesting things that comes up for me a lot in these conversations is the way that marginalized communities or low-income communities have been being sustainable, and it's just not been what we've been calling sustainability. I think back to growing up in the Bahamas, we would reuse containers all the time, and that was just like a way of life. Or, you know, when you're in a situation where someone at your church in your community has, you know, clothes that are too small, you just, you know, donate them and you give them to somebody else. And those are just, you know, basic things that we tend to think about. It's just, this is how we live, this is how we close the loop. But, you know, I guess when you don't have that access to those resources to be able to go thrifting or X, Y, and Z, you just feel really disconnected. So I think my advice in situations like that is always to reframe what we mean by sustainability. And I loved what Tahira was talking about in terms of removing that shaming culture, because I think it is very easy to feel hopeless and, you know, to feel like you're not being sustainable if you're not really participating in this glamorized and frankly gentrified version of what sustainability is. So in those moments, I always try to remind people that being sustainable is always just doing the best that you can with whatever's been provided to you. And I think leaning into your community that way and being like, okay, this is what our situation is. How can we make the best use of the resources that we do have instead of trying to outsource or instead of trying to overconsume, to try to bring in resources, especially in terms of like shipping costs as well. I would think about how counterintuitive it would be sometimes, this whole idea of my friends being like, okay, I want to like shop more at ethical brands. So they would go and shop at this place in the UK and have that try to get shipped all the way to the Bahamas, thinking about, you know, flying and the air miles and then getting it shipped on a boat instead of, you know, I guess doing something that might not be as what we stereotypically think about as sustainable. But long-winded way to say, my advice in that is definitely just to use the resources that you have and don't fall into the shaming culture of sustainability. Also, a comment that I want to make, because I did see it again, I'm on too much on TikTok, which is why I'm here for the Gen Z perspective, but there was a TikTok I saw about this thing that's happening now called ThriftCon. And I think within fashion and sustainable fashion, thrifting is what we think of most often. And this whole idea that thrifting, when it began, was really this way for low-income communities to be able to get, you know, access to affordable clothing. And now, because thrifting has become so popularized within like sustainability, but mostly within white Gen Z people, it's now the prices are going up and it's turning into a affordable thing that people are flying across the country to go to ThriftCon, which is some thrifting convention. And it's just completely removed itself from what's actually sustainable in that way. So all that to say, do the best that you can with what you have.
Yes, I always say progress, not perfection, but, and yes, using the resources that you have. I want to make sure that we had some time to talk about activism, because we got a really great question from Kathy King. She said, suggestions for gentle ways to push back on plastic and clothing among our favorite brands. And I feel like it's funny that she said gentle, because I'm like, well, we can't be gentle. We need to be direct.
I just also wanted to just echo what Lauren and Tahira were saying, that we say it quite a controversial thing, I guess, in the sustainable fashion space, that sustainable fashion doesn't exist, because it really, like, what matters, I mean, I think where the problem has become is like, it's a new marketing category, right? To create these like new product things for people to purchase more of. And I've seen decks like of you know, multi-brand retailers that say like, what are the new trends? It's like leopard print and bright colors and sustainable. Like, if sustainability is a trend, you're not achieving anything. That's just like marketing to a new category of consumers. I just wanted to, I love what you guys were saying about that. And it is true that, you know, just having your clothing longer, which is how marginalized communities have had to do it, is the right thing to do from the beginning. And so there really should be a lot of ownership around sustainability in that regard. Anyway, in terms of the plastic and the policy and kind of what we can ask brands to do, we're really at the very earliest stages, which is a terrible thing because the pollution is at such an enormous rate. But at the moment, brands are not even disclosing the very basics of how much material they are producing. So we are forced, kind of when we're thinking of policy, to pull from really like old studies of 10 years old that have even begun to estimate how many units of clothing are produced annually. So I think as a very starting point, I'm sure Mari has other thoughts as well, and I'd actually really like to hear hers, is that we need to start with just a very basic disclosure around how much material is actually being produced. Because we cannot, manage what we do not measure. And if we are not even measuring how much material is being produced, we can't see if we're making any progress. And so that as a starting point and kind of understand the material breakdown, we can at least begin to get a sense of the scope. I mean, we're seeing the scope of the problem because we're seeing the research coming out on the other end in the oceans and the sky and the water we drink. But we're not, able to see it at the source. And so we need that information just at the jump in order to begin to drive things down. And then as Andrea said, like we have to get to the business model because we're not gonna, it's not just about, we have to shift from plastic to natural fibers. Natural fibers has their own issues. We really have to take this on holistically.
Yeah, I agree with Maxine. I also think transparency from brands is gonna be a huge thing. I think, the way that brands measure success needs to change. So it's not just every year, we have to keep hitting this number, because the only way you keep hitting the number is by producing more stuff. So it's maybe the way that you measure success should be different. Maybe that one year it's were we able to incorporate a new fabric this year? Great. That's a measure of success rather than were we able to sell 5,000 pairs of jeans? I think that's big. And I also think the Black Lives Matter movement and kind of just Stop Asian Hate are two really good examples of making brands take a stand. I think from pressure on social media and pressure just in the media, I think obviously very different fights, but I do think that's a really good way to you have to push brands. I don't think brands are going to be you know what, today we really want to stop selling all these clothes. I think it has to be we have to be we don't want this anymore, and so you have to stop doing it, because brands can be H&M is a great example. H&M has their conscious line, but then they're still producing all their other clothes, so it's you can't, that's greenwashing in a sense. So it's just so you have this line, but you, even same with cleaning companies, you have this clean brand line, but you're still producing this other line. So it's just I think we just need to push brands to kind of give us more transparency, more answers, and really make that public and known. That's my two cents.
I'd add that you can make changes through, driving the market. Like was said before, you can choose what you want to buy. That is from what you understand to the best of your ability to be, has less plastic in it, to be more sustainable. You can also still send an email to them and say, hey, I wish I could get more information on this. Or I just opened this package and it smells funny. Can you tell me the details of, what chemicals you use to process your clothing? I think the more people know about this, so even if you're not just talking to the brands themselves, talking to people around you and sharing that information that we should all be more aware of and attentive to, but don't get lost in it, because there's way too many things in the world that are difficult. But it is really about education, awareness, making your choice with your voice, with your vote, with your dollar, endorsing changes on a policy level to make companies provide more information on where their textiles are coming from, how they're processed, what are the working conditions associated to the people that are processing these clothing or, chemicals that are used in them. There's multiple things you can do, and all of them are important and valid, and do what makes you feel most comfortable, really.
And sorry, just to add one more thing, I think that the beauty industry is a great example. Obviously, the beauty industry has their like issues with plastic as well. But when it comes to ingredients, like when you think about how every brand is like, we don't test on animals, we don't use parabens, we don't use sulfates, all these like things that now brands know that consumers want to know. I think like that was a fight that consumers were like, what's in my products? What's this going to do to me? And everyone just kept asking questions and like pressuring brands. And now every single brand is like, we don't use these products or we don't do this. And like, obviously the beauty industry has other issues within just like waste and things like that. But I think that's a really good example of like the consumers and the people pushing brands for like the answers they need.
Thank you so much. I think we have time for one more question. Somebody asked about how COVID has affected the fashion industry. And I think, Tahira, you were started to talk about this, that pre-COVID up to 20% of fashion was never worn or sold and destined for the trash. Is that still true? You know, I know there was a whole Burberry scandal. Can anyone speak to whether or not those wasteful practices are still taking place?
I happened to be visiting the company that was responsible for destroying the Burberry product in China. And at the time, I mean, the scandal was that it was like uncovered and it was surprising to people because that is just like how the industry operated. I think that was at least eye-opening to me in hearing that perspective. But I think that, and I guess turning to the policy side of this as well on the front end is like, the problem is the creation of the product itself. And again, this like just keeps going back to, I think the common theme from all of us today is like the business models behind this stuff. But once the product is made, you know, the resources have been utilized and it's going to exist in some form, like either you burn it and it will emit greenhouse gases, but its legacy will continue on. And so I think the industry really has to just like get a handle of how much it's producing, like, and we can't make kind of marginal effort, like works on the side.
Very last question from Jackie Garcia. What can we do to prevent microfibers from getting released through our laundry? So maybe Mari, you can.
Yeah, I'll answer that. And then I'll also just add my quick closing thoughts so we can get through everybody's. So to reduce microfibers in particular, when we're washing our clothes, we need to think about washing cold. If we're using laundry machines, washing even with things like a Cora ball, those are usually about $30, $40 if you want to buy those, or adding a filter to your washer machine. Those usually with installation can sometimes be about $140. So it just depends on if that is accessible for you. And then there's also these guppy bags that have also been shown to reduce microfibers. But the best one is the inline filters for laundry machines. And that's one I think we should be urging all new laundry machines that are built to build in these removal systems of microfibers that are accessible, no different from our dryer systems removing lint, which is microfibers. If you want to just take a look, that's what I'm talking about. Just line drying your clothes as much as possible too, because it's not just water. It is, you know, when you're drying things, you'll capture some of the lint, but it is going to be thrown into the air depending on how your laundry machine works. And then just closing thoughts of all of this is just think about, you know, what you're wearing, how you're caring for it. And it, even if you decide to buy a plastic clothing, it's, you know, perfectly normal. It's just how you care for it and mend it and love on it and continue to use it and reuse it for your purposes.
Thank you so much. If everyone wants to say a few last remarks, we'll start with Lauren.
I just want to hammer in, I guess, what we've talked about a lot of the time that we've spent in this conversation about this whole idea of what the next steps are and what people should do to get involved. I think this idea of making sure that we're not being gentle with brands, that we are demanding transparency and that we are asking of them to be upfront with what's in their products. And like the example with the beauty industry, once you hammer in those ideas, there's really only so much that they can do if they still want to sell their products. So making sure that we're just like, hey, we want clean products. Hey, we want you to stop using plastic. We want X, Y, and Z. And really doing that when it comes to brands is one way that I think that we can also make progress. There was a question that I wanted to answer that I don't think we had time to do, but this whole idea of, especially for younger generations, with this idea that you can only really wear clothes once, and if you're caught in the same outfit twice, that's a whole, I guess, faux pas, or like the fashion police are going to come for you, whatever. And I think that's really been hammered in, especially for young women, for a very, very long time, that it's terrible to be an outfit repeater. And that kind of leads into fast fashion and this idea of if you're always wanting to be seen in a different outfit, or trying to find like affordable or cheap ways to always buy new clothes, you're going to lean into fast fashion. So with that, I would really want to say and give some advice to anyone who might be feeling that way, that, you know, I think that's something that's not true, and it's just something that's really been reinforced through stereotypes, but outfit repeating or outfit repetition is not at all a big deal the way that media makes it seem. And if you love your clothes, who cares? If you love it, wear it, enjoy it. Nobody cares as much as you think that they do. That's something that I had to learn the hard way, especially with like repeating outfits on Instagram. But yeah, I would just really want to hammer that home, that wear what you like, and do the best that you can. And those are my little closing thoughts.
Thank you so much. Yes, I love that. Normalizing repeating, you know, repeat outfits. Okay, Tyra, do you want to say a couple last remarks?
Sure. I like that too, Lauren, normalizing repeating outfits. I totally agree. And I also just think my closing thoughts would be like, take it one step at a time. I think like, if you're like, okay, this month I really wanna try to not shop here for a month, or this month I really wanna try, this season I wanna just like wear what's in my closet, or I wanna, you know, like take it step by step. Don't feel overwhelmed by like all the things that you're reading, because then it'll make you so overwhelmed. You're like, okay, I'm fine. I don't need to do anything. So I think just pick and choose, and because no one's perfect. And at the end of the day, the onus should not only be on us. It should be on companies, because that's where the real change is going to come. So don't think that you need to save the world, but like definitely feel like you want to change the way that you're shopping and change the way that you're consuming and what you wear and things like that. I think it's important just to like help society. But again, I think the onus is on industries and corporations to change, and not just on you. So remember that.
Thank you so much. Yes. And Maxine, you want to say a few last remarks?
I was just saying, to piggyback on what Tahira, Lauren, and Amari were saying, I think, you know, like we've used this word consumer a lot today, in this past hour. And even that word of speaking to some psychology researchers on this creates, there's been all sorts of research, especially with children, that when you kind of use this word consumer, that there's more like consumeristic tendencies that come out of just that activation of that word. And how that ties into what Tahira was saying is that, you know, ultimately, this is about, you know, what are the corporations doing? And it isn't all on us as individuals to make the right like purchasing choice, but we are citizens, and we are people who have a voice with brands, you know, with the people who represent us in government. And I think that kind of the amazing takeaway from the works of the Black Lives Matter movement is that idea of citizenship and having one's voice heard and demanding, you know, that voices are heard. So I think, you know, I would just say that, you know, a lot of these things we have to address with policy, but we're the ones who guide what policy happens. And so we have an amazing role to play as citizens in all of this.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I mean, this has been incredibly, just an incredible discussion. So thank you, Lauren. Thank you, Maxine, Amari, and Tahira, and to everyone for tuning in. So we're taking a break from our webinar series in May. We'll be back on Wednesday, June 23rd at 2 p.m. Pacific time, 5 p.m. Eastern time, with Sasha Adkins and Brittany Davis to talk about the ethics of plastic. We also invite you to join us at our 2021 Magnificent May virtual concert on Saturday, May 22nd from 6 p.m. Pacific Standard Time to 9 p.m. Eastern Time. This unique acoustic concert will feature Ben Harper, Keb Mo, Inara George, Mandy Moore and Taylor Goldsmith, Watkins Family Hour, Mike Viola, Jackson Brown. We're offering a $25 general admission ticket for the concert. And if you'd like to support at a higher level, of course, please contact us about premium and VIP tickets and sponsorship opportunities. We invite you to get involved with us. There's information there for how to join the coalition, support our work. And if you have any further questions, please do not hesitate to contact us. And last but not least, we'll be sending out a link to a survey, and we would love to get your feedback on today's webinar. Thank you. Thank you again to everyone for joining today. I hope everyone leaves feeling inspired as a citizen to phase plastic out of fashion.